In this video, we want to compute the capacitance of the coaxial capacitor, also called the cylindrical shell capacitor. And the usual procedure here is to put opposite charges on the two conductors. Then we calculate the potential difference between the conductors, in other words, the voltage. And then we use the definition of capacitance. And that's our basic definition of capacitance. It's the charge per volt, so Q over V. But one big difference for this capacitor is that we frame everything in terms of a linear charge density instead of a total charge. So you can see in the diagram, we've put a charge density of plus lambda on the inner shell. The units of linear charge density, again, are coulombs per meter. And we have a linear charge density of negative lambda on the outer shell. And what we're actually computing is capacitance per unit length for the long cylindrical capacitor. And we see that capacitance per unit length is just charge per unit length divided by the potential difference. But charge per unit length, we call that lambda. So the capacitance per unit length is going to be lambda divided by V. And again, the basic strategy here is we put those linear charge densities on the two shells. We compute the potential difference V. And then we take lambda over V and we'll have our capacitance per unit length. So to get the potential difference between the two conductors, we need to know the electric field between the two conductors. And in the previous video, we just computed that electric field by using Gauss's law. As it turned out, the electric field between the two conductors was lambda, the linear charge density, divided by 2 pi epsilon 0 times R. Next, we want to compute the potential difference between the two conductors. And this requires computing a path integral. So we choose the simplest path from one conductor to the next. And I labeled our starting point as point number one, our finishing point as point number two. And we're just going to move radially outward from that inner positively charged shell to the outer negatively charged shell. And our potential difference, V1 minus V2, is given by the path integral of the electric field dotted into the path increment dl, taken from our starting point one to our finishing point two. And I'll post a link to the video where this potential difference path integral was first introduced. Now there are a couple simplifications to make here. First, we're free to choose the reference point for the zero of the electric potential. And typically you would use the point of the lowest potential in the problem. So that's going to be on the outer shell. And we're going to say that V2 is equal to zero. The second thing is that along the path we've created, dl, the path length increment, is really just an increment of radius dr. So dl and dr are the same thing. And the electric field is parallel to dr for every single path increment. So the dot product becomes trivial, and we just end up with a product inside this integral. So our potential difference is really just the potential on the inner shell, which we're just going to call V. And our integral is the integral of E times dr, because the dot product was trivial. And then our starting value of R is going to be A, the radius of the inner shell, and our finishing value of R is B, the radius of the outer shell. Now we can plug in our previous result for the electric field between the shells. So we have the integral from A to B of lambda over 2 pi epsilon 0 R dr. Now the lambda over 2 pi epsilon 0, that's a constant, so we can think of just factoring that out in front of the integral. That leaves us with the integral of 1 over R, which is the natural log of R. So our potential difference is lambda over 2 pi epsilon 0 natural log of R evaluated from A to B. When we plug in those limits of integration, we get the natural log of B minus the natural log of A, but we can use log properties to write that as a natural log of B divided by A. So our potential difference between the two plates is lambda over 2 pi epsilon 0 natural log of B divided by A. Now we just have to get back to our original plan for computing the capacitance per unit length. We're going to take lambda, the linear charge density on the conductors, and divide by that potential difference, V. So there's a little reminder of our result for the potential difference, a little reminder of how we're going to get the capacitance per unit length, and we can just go ahead and simplify the algebra. So the capacitance per unit length is lambda divided by the potential difference between the plates, which was lambda over 2 pi epsilon 0, natural log of B over A. The lambdas cancel out here, and my 2 pi epsilon 0 ends up in the numerator. And so our capacitance per unit length is 2 pi epsilon 0 divided by natural log of B over A. In the next video, we continue our investigation into the cylindrical shell capacitor by calculating the energy per unit length stored in the capacitor. And we're going to do this in two different ways, and of course we'll make sure the two answers agree with each other. You can click to that video at the upper left, and I'll see you there.